group. Reba. She's kind of like me. She doesn't need a second name. She has been called the queen of country music. She's sold 20 million albums. She's won practically every honor a music star can receive. As an actress, she has co-starred with Burt Reynolds and Kenny Rogers. She's appearing in a new film directed by Rob Reiner. Now she is also a successful author to boot with her autobiography, which is on the New York Times bestseller list. On top of all this, she finds time for a 400-acre horse farm and a number of very important causes. I mean, we have so much in common. Well, you know, because I'm very busy myself. And in fact, I was just thinking about this last night while I was counting how many times the washer goes around during the spin cycle. But enough about me. Also with us today is Reba's pal, Linda Davis. They recorded the Grammy-winning duet, Does He Love You, together, and they are both going to sing for us today. In the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Reba McEntire.
Thank you so much.
How you been?
I'm great.
Thanks. Y'all.
Sit yourself down. We do have so much in common, only I bought those shoes in the flat. Because I'm a little older than you.
This is the first time I've ever worn these shoes, and I haven't worn platforms in
They're really comfortable, though, aren't they?
Yeah, but you take little bitty steps. And, you know, it's not like a high heel. You just kind of clop along, so it's really different.
You're a little younger than I am. When I was young, I wore those every day of my life, those platforms. Even to Disneyland. So, when are you going to write the second book?
Oh, my goodness. I said the last page of my book. Whoever mentioned that again, I'd have to choke a liver out of them.
Really? Oh, well, I do. Would make for good ratings, probably. Go for it. Kind of like you used to eat Rocky Mountain oysters, huh?
Absolutely, absolutely.
You know, you said that last time you were here, and it's like I've heard the term, but it didn't really register. And somebody today on the staff said, but you have to explain what those are.
Because, mountain oysters?
Yeah. They're from when you...
I like the way you're explaining it a lot better than the way I explain it. Well, Vicki, let me put it to you this way. When we were kids, Daddy had about an 8,000-acre ranch, and in the spring, he would get in, or before spring, he would get in bulls from Louisiana, Florida, and they would ship into Oklahoma, and we'd get them off the truck, and we'd have to work them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you say work them, you have to brand them for identification, ear tag them, that way you know whose they are,
mm-hmm.
Because they jump fences and go off to other people's pastures.
Right.
You have to earmark them. And then we'll give them their shots to make sure they don't get sick.
Mm-hmm.
And then? Well, I'll just put it to you this way. When we got through with them, they were a high-pitched soprano.
You would castrate them.
Exactly.
And then Mom would just kind of fry them up with a nice salad and a little vinaigrette dressing. And
well, what we'd do is, Daddy would hand them to us, and we'd put them in a bucket. Then Alice and Susie and myself would take the bucket to the house, and we'd sit on the back porch and clean them. And then we'd take them into Mama, and she'd slice them thin and roll them in flour and cook them, and we'd have them for dinner. You want to come to my house?
As I said, with a nice little green salad with
exactly.
A little vinaigrette dressing. Does this make Marvel nervous at all, this...
He messes with me, buddy.
You know exactly what you're doing, and you're going to go right over to Mama's house and hook them on up there.
Yep.
I'll see your Lorena Bobbitt and raise
That's
you
what
one
I was gonna
Reba
say.
McEntire.
Would my name be Reba Bobbitt by that time?
Now listen. Reba Bobbitt, I like it. We have too much in common. You know, because I was just saying that the last time you were here was the first time I ever met you.
Uh-huh.
And I felt after talking to you that I could totally go out to shopping and to lunch with this gal and we
Absolutely.
Would just get along great.
Absolutely. I feel the same
then
way.
Then I'm looking around and reading and I find out that our birth dates are 2 days apart.
Mine's March 28th.
I'm March 26th.
No kidding. Well,
and
we
we're both
together.
Natural redheads.
Yes.
We have, and, you know, although we come from such different backgrounds, the roads have been very, very similar.
Mm-hmm.
And in reading the book, a lot of similarities. And I am right in the process of writing my book now.
Are you really?
Oh, Reba,
isn't it tough?
It's so hard, isn't it?
It is. It's grueling.
It's like going through psychotherapy. Well, it is.
It is exactly. It was the hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life. I didn't enjoy it. Some parts of it. No, some parts I really did. I enjoyed the early years and remembering all what we'd done and the fun times we'd had and times on the road. The two things that I really didn't want to put in the book at all, but I knew I had to because I knew that's what y'all wanted to know about, was my divorce to Charlie Battles and also the plane crash in 91. Mm-hmm. Those were really hard to talk about, but more than anything, the plane crash.
Is it because inquiring minds are a little confused that they want to know about it? Are they really nosy or...
Well, I'll take it a nicer approach. I think my fans are they really truly like me, and I think I know that I really like them too. So the things that they've read on the tabloids and heard speculation of what had happened, I think I owe that to them to tell them what exactly happened and why I did divorce Charlie.
So how honest were you?
Very honest.
I mean, were you perfectly forthcoming and you told them everything? Because, you know, when you're going through the process, it's like, oh, God, I don't know if I want this to be in black and white.
Yeah.
And...
The thing that I would do is Tom Carter, who helped me with the book, who was my co-author, he would interview me. And then I would tell him everything. And then
everything?
Everything. And once we got it on paper, I would say, Tom, this might hurt somebody's feelings. Or this might embarrass this person.
Can you worry about that when you're writing a book? Whose feelings you're going to hurt?
I didn't want to hurt anybody's feelings. I didn't want to embarrass anybody. But now, there were some funny stories I had to tell. Now, whether they embarrassed them or not, I had to tell it. I think.
Yeah.
It had to be told.
Because your divorce reminded me a lot of my first marriage too. A lot of similarities, like when I went home to get my belongings and nothing was mine, and I mean, literally gave him everything and said, "I'm going. I'm leaving. It's yours."
Freedom costs, you know? Doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
It's worth it.
Yeah. Now listen, here's another similarity. The tabloids. And, you know, for some reason...
I haven't seen this one, Vicki.
I know you... Well, it's just out on the stands. It's a wonderful thing. I'm only on page 15. You make the cover.
I did?
But, well, you've made the cover.
Oh, I have made the cover.
I'm slowly working my way up to the cover.
Uh-huh.
But once you are a talk show host, everybody wants to do things to you. You know?
Uh-huh.
I don't know why. When I was mama, nobody gave a damn. This is very similar.
I was pregnant when vicious Vicki Lawrence shacked up with my husband.
Mm-hmm.
That's nice.
Fuming ex-wife rips into cheating talk show star.
Yeah.
You went through a similar stuff.
Very similar.
I don't think you want to read about this.
And there. Yeah.
So in your book, you attempt to set the record straight because you had, what, two ex-wives on your case?
Two ex-wives on my case, and they said I stole their husbands, which
both
I did not steal their husbands.
Simultaneously did you do this?
Well,
different
yeah,
times.
One after, different times, yeah.
At different times.
Yeah.
And they come out of the woodwork years down the road.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think you can become Reba McEntire, a huge star, and not offend a lot of people along the way, or a number of...
No, you do offend people because you move on with your life and you change. A lot of people don't grow when you grow, and you can either stay there where they are or you have to grow and go on with your life.
So what do you do about something like that? Because that hurts.
The thing that I did is that I talked about it. And after every one of my concerts, when people would say, Reba, did you really steal their husbands? And I said, well, I did wind up with them, but I didn't steal them. You can't steal somebody that's wanting to go away in the first place, mm-hmm. away from that woman. So I would talk it over with my fans, and I'm very open with my fans. And I think that helped me. And it helped them, and they didn't want to believe it in the first place. But in a way it is, I guess you could say it's true, that I wound up marrying them, but I did not steal them.
Yeah. And then the divorce, do people tend to pass judgment on you when you're getting a divorce?
There was one woman that wrote a real heavy letter to me and said, how dare you get a divorce? You know, how do you answer something like that?
I don't know.
Said that she patterned her life after me and that she had me on a pedestal and she truly idolized me. And I wrote her back and I said, well, ma'am. And well, she said she stayed with her husband because I stayed with my husband. I said, first of all, you need to not look up to me because I'm just a human that makes huge mistakes just like everybody else. And if you want to find someone that's perfect, you need to look to God because he's the only one that's perfect. And I told her I was terribly sorry that I had to do what I needed to do in my life to go on with my life. And I really did feel for staying with her husband just because I did. I said, you need to really...
Look at your own life.
Look at your own life and think about things a little bit more. And don't go look at other people, how they're doing their life.
Yeah. We have to take a break, but more advice from Reba when we come back.
Oh,
and
yeah.
She's going to give us the lowdown on her early career. You got lots of back of the bus hijinks stories that are a lot of fun.
Lots of fun stuff
yeah.
on the bus, you bet.
Stick around. We'll be back. Said that my special guest today can sing the paint off a barn. We're talking albums. Is that a good thing? We're talking album sales over 20 million, you guys. I'm here with country music legend Reba McEntire.
Thank you.
You signed your first record contract in 1975.
Mm-hmm.
How long before you actually saw money residuals?
From my records, probably 1988.
Why was that?
Because I didn't sell any records.
So you just spent that whole time just really on the road?
On the road, that's how I made my living, absolutely. Selling t-shirts and doing live performances.
Yeah. Tell us about being on the road. Were you in a bus in those days?
Well, at the beginning, no. When I had my contract with Polygram Mercury, Susie and I, my little sister, she sang harmony with me. We would be in a car, and then the band would be in a van pulling a trailer. And sometimes the van leaked real bad because it was one of those conversion bubble top vans. Real wild colors inside. And we were down in Florida playing one time, and we just went through a thunderstorm. And they said that it leaked like a sieve. It was just terrible. And Susie and I, in 1981, we finally got our first bus, and it broke down so many times. We had one bus driver, bless his heart. The bus didn't like him. Didn't like him at all.
Really?
The bus broke down every day. He worked for me and drove for me for 17 days. Every day the bus broke down.
So after 17 days, he said, I'm out of here.
He said, I'm out of here.
Love you, babe. I'm out of here.
He said, I think I'm going to quit. I said, I think that's a real good idea.
So it's hard to find a good driver. That's
You know what? Right after he left us, we had another guy stay with us for a little bit, and then he had to go back home, and then I found the jewel, Larry Jones, who is from Duncan, Oklahoma. He came to work for me, and last year marked his 10th year with me, so he's been with me 11 years.
Wow, so he's doing really well.
Yeah, yeah, he's the head of Starstruck Transportation.
Narvel started playing steel guitar for you when?
1980.
And you didn't even say hello to him the day he showed up.
Now, he said that. He told Tom Carter that, but for the book interview. And I'm sure I did. I'm a nice
person. Well, I'm just figuring. You were under the gun. You had a concert to do, and somebody said, there's a new guy on the steel guitar. Let's go.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
What happened that day, they all showed up at the Chalky Shack, where they were performing, I mean, where they were rehearsing, and they all met up there, and Narvel drove up from Burleson, Texas, about a three-hour drive, and they all piled in, but at that time it was a truck mm-hmm. and a horse trailer where they put all the instruments in, and they all drove up to Nowata, Oklahoma. Now, it was a VFW, and it was a very small hall. It was, the whole thing was probably bigger than, not bigger than this room,
mm-hmm.
and it was divided by a partition, so you were singing up to a wall. And then the people were around by. I didn't never understand that, but there was a few tables right there in front. And we walked in, and we didn't have time to rehearse or anything. That was the first time I saw Narvel.
Mm-hmm.
But now, he was a good-looking rascal.
Yeah, I was going to say, now, what'd you think when you first saw him? You had to think something.
He was very intimidating because he was so good-looking.
Yeah, pretty cute.
And, but he was a city boy. And I was, to him, a country bumpkin.
Mm-hmm.
So, Narvel and I, it was really funny that we ever wound up together.
And you were married, and
uh-huh.
he was married.
Uh-huh.
See, this is like me, too.
See?
Al and I worked together on the Carol Burnett Show, and we used to double date.
Really?
Yeah, him and his ex-wife and me and my ex-husband, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So when did your bodies slam together and you fell to the ground and the sweat pouring off here and your heart's beating so hard that you couldn't tell whether it was yours or his, and you said, oh, I'm in deep trouble now.
Vicki?
When?
You've been reading too many of them tabloids.
Uh-uh. When?
You know, I don't know when.
Really?
I don't know when exactly that we actually decided we were meant for each other. I don't know when. I was going through a divorce, and he helped me through that whole time. He was my tour manager at the time. So he went with me to all the depositions, to the courthouse, and helped me through it. And all that respect and admiration, you know, when people help you through things, you know, that's a pretty close bond.
But he was a friend.
Yeah.
I mean, a really good friend.
Well,
first.
And two, he was my business associate. Bill Carter was my manager at the time, and he came in for a few of the things. But I had to have somebody with me, you know, to go up with me, because I just can't troop around the country all by myself, you know.
But you must remember the first time that your bodies slammed together.
She likes that word, slam, doesn't she?
Don't you? I mean, I remember it vividly, the first time mine and Al's bodies collided.
When was this, Vicki?
Well, that'll be in my book, but I don't know.
I just don't remember.
Well, I guess that says a lot about you, Narvel, doesn't it?
Boy, is he gonna really be
mad at
me.
You know what he's gonna do tonight? He, your bodies are gonna slam together. And he's gonna say, remember this, babe.
Is it hot in here, y'all?
Just think about it all day, Reba. Reba's gonna sing when we come back.
No, I gotta go. No.
You've got such an exciting day ahead of you. A little later, we're going to reveal the surprise guest that's waiting in the wings. Chew on all this, Reba. We'll be back.
It's hot in here.
Everyday people confront extraordinary events.
The building dropped about 12 feet within 5.
North, I'm Paul Texas. Here's Ma Tex.
Howdy.
And welcome to the great state of Texas.
Multi-talented guest, country superstar Reba McEntire in Rob Reiner's new film, North. Dan Aykroyd?
Elijah Woods, and a cast of thousands.
Tell us about working with Dan Aykroyd.
Oh,
is he hysterical?
He is so nice. He's very, very serious. You know, we would get all of us in the makeup trailer and hair trailer. Mm-hmm. We'd all get in there and we'd get Dan to tell us stories about the Blues Brothers and all the fun stuff that he's done in his past. Mm-hmm. And Elijah Woods, he's the star of North. He is a great kid, wonderful kid.
He's adorable.
He's just.
I know. I was just asking you, where do I know him from?
Huckleberry Finn, just tons of movies that he's been on. But he's so level. He's always in a great mood. But he's sit there and just be mesmerized by Dan Aykroyd.
Bruce Willis?
Yeah, he's in it. I got to meet him.
Well, tell us about Bruce.
Bruce is a very handsome man, y'all. I didn't have to tell them that, did I? They know that.
Yeah.
But he's very nice, very polite, walks right up to you, shakes your hand, says, hi, I'm Bruce Willis.
But is he a guy's guy, or does he get along with girls? He strikes me as sort of like a man's man.
God, I didn't even notice anything about any other man on the set. When Bruce Willis walked on, he is so handsome. I think definitely he could be a woman's man, yes.
That's not exactly what I meant, but...
He
probably bonds with guys more than he bonds with... But that's just my own personal observation. I've never seen him. How's his hair holding up?
He had a hat on.
Oh, he had a hat on?
Yeah.
He had a hat on, America! Your new LP is entitled Read My Mind.
Uh-huh.
And it's different than your previous albums in that it's sort of more passionate.
It is very romantic. I've got 3 romantic songs on it. And I usually don't find romantic songs. They're all kind of syrupy, the ones I find.
Is it that you don't find them, or is it that you sort of choose to record stuff that's kind of where your mind is at the time of the album?
That's part of it. But usually I don't find real good, deep romantic songs for people who've been married a while.
So that's more the focus of this album?
No, that's one song. Another song, it's a wide variety.
Is that the one you're going to sing for us?
No, the one I'm going to sing for y'all is a real sassy song. It's about this guy that won't call her back.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, I think you should probably go sing for us.
I'll go do it right now.
That's one of our favorite things that you do.
An old boy named Bell invented a contraption that we know so well. By the 1950s, they're in everybody's home. It's this crazy little thing they call the telephone. Now there's one on every corner, in the back of every bar. You can get going in your briefcase on a plane or in your car. So tell me why. Well, there's no problem getting to me, baby. You can dial direct. I got call forward and call waiting. You can even call collect. The service man, he told me that my phone was working fine, and I have come to the conclusion trouble isn't with my line. I'm sure the operator will be glad to put you through, so dial zero for assistance if this all confuses you. So tell me why.
That is one of the ways my Grammy Award-winning guest Reba McEntire is giving back to the community. Tell us a little about that video.
Well, it was a song I recorded after the plane crash in 91, and then the St. Jude people came to us and said that they would like to do a video for St. Jude, and MOR, which is one of the video channels, they went in with us and we put this together. I think it's a wonderful video. It portrays something that you really don't want to be addressed with a lot of times, and that's mm-hmm. children get sick. And having a four-year-old, it's real hard for me to watch that video mm-hmm. because that could be my kid. And so I think that's why I wanted to do it so bad. I don't like to sing that song because it reminds me too much of the hurtful things. But anything that I can do for St. Jude, because I've referred quite a few people to St. Jude, and they've taken care of them, they've helped them. Some didn't make it,
yeah,
but at least they got another chance to mm-hmm. try to survive, and that's why I wanted to do that video.
Tell us about the Reba Ranch House, which is another thing that you started after the plane crash, yeah?
The Reba Ranch House is a project that I'm very proud of because it's in Denison, Texas. It's right below the hill at the Denison, or at the Texoma Medical Center, and what it is, it's like a Ronald McDonald House, except it's not only for kids' families who are in the hospital. It's for anybody who's in the hospital. It's for their family to stay. It's an 8-bedroom ranch house, and it's got a beautiful living room and a library and a playroom along with the 8 bedrooms. And so if you have family members that are at the Texoma Medical Center, you have a place to stay.
Mm-hmm. Habitat for Humanity, that's another one that you're involved with.
That was really neat. We, a bunch of women in Nashville, got together and built Gail Kinzer and her 2 children a house. I did the funding and they did the work. They wouldn't let me have a hammer for some reason. I told them about the only thing I could do is hang a picture. And so they wouldn't, but I did hang the door and it hadn't fallen off yet, so that's good.
Now, how'd you pick the person to build the house for? Because you picked her.
Well, no, the Habitat for Humanity people chose her because they went through a lot of ladies who were hardworking women, mm-hmm. who had jobs, but just needed that extra push, a little bit of help from their fellow women, and we were there to help her. So they chose Gail Kinzer, and she's a great gal. I love her to pieces, and now what she does is she'll give back, and she'll go help on another Habitat for Humanity house, mm-hmm. and pay back. She doesn't have to exactly pay for the house. She makes a payment, which just takes care of the insurance and stuff like that.
Right, so it's sort of like a pass it on kind of a deal.
Exactly.
Well, she wanted to come and say hi to you today. Gail Kinzer is here.
Are you serious?
You. I love surprises.
So flabbergasted.
Don't you love surprises?
I do. How's your house?
Lovely. Lovely.
How's your kids doing?
Wonderful. I have a story to tell.
Okay.
That Brianna, my 2-year-old, saw your picture in the back seat of my car, and I make them take their shoes off when they come in the house. And she was looking at your picture. She said, Mama, that lady is getting our rug dirty. And I said, who are you talking about? And she said, Reba McEntire. I said,
McEntire?
She said, that Reba lady is getting our rug dirty. She took pictures in it, but it's lovely.
Now, how bad were your living conditions before you got this house? I mean, how were you chosen?
Well, I had applied a few years back, and I was living in subsidized housing at the time. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, gambling there. We hear shooting, and someone had broken into my apartment.
Where
like
was
the week.
This, Gail?
This was in Nashville, in some subsidized apartments based on your income, and it was really pretty bad. I never let my kids go out and play. You know, they could only just go on the breezeway, and that was only for a few minutes.
And you're a single mom?
Yes, I'm a single mom.
So you were doing the juggling all this alone?
Yes, and you know, we would come home from work. I would come home and have the kids in the car, and Dominique would always ask me, what were these guys doing? And they would be gambling, you know, and I couldn't get up the steps to get into my apartment because mm-hmm. they would just be right there in the walkway.
So what happens when you're chosen? You get a phone call?
Yes, you get 2 phone interviews and 2 home interviews. And when I got my first phone interview, I was like, okay, I got an interview. This is good.
She was so excited about
it. I was really excited. So I got 2 phone interviews. And it takes a while because they don't tell you exactly when you'll hear from them again.
Yeah.
And I think it took a few months after my first interview, phone interview, and then I had moved after they broke into my apartment. I moved out, I mean, I just moved. And then they called me and told me a week before Christmas that I was chosen to get
And then how long to build the house?
9 days.
9 days?
9 days.
It was all women?
All women. How many women?
Thank you.
Yeah!
All right.
There were 400 women.
All right, 400 women,
400
9
women,
days.
And we had to turn away 200, over 200 women.
Isn't that fabulous?
All volunteers.
All volunteers.
Isn't
yes.
that terrific?
It's
so
a good
so the next house you're going to help build, yeah?
Right, I've already started. They've built 3 homes over on Ireland Street in Nashville, and I've already started helping with that.
Isn't that so great? And you said a dove landed on your roof or something?
Yes, the Saturday that we finished, a dove came down and walked on the top of the roof all the way to the end, the front of the house, and came down.
I hadn't heard that. That's great.
It probably left a little surprise on the roof.
Yeah. It was wonderful.
Oh, I'm glad you could come
program.
And visit. Yeah, it sounds like a fabulous program. Well, now, y'all remember Reba's smash duet, Does He Love You? Her co-star Linda Davis is going to perform when we come back.
If you haven't I heard from you.
Mr. Bubble.
Well, fun. We're back. with Reba McEntire. Now, the really important news is that Shelby is potty trained.
Yep.
And you should look at him. Oh, for heaven's
sake. He's been potty trained
sake.
For about a year. He was real good about it. We had a fun game going. Every time I said, now, Shelby, if you have to go to the bathroom, you come tell me, okay? And he'd run up to me. I don't know why little boys always wait for the last minute, but Shelby did. Mm-hmm. And he'd run and say, pee-pee, mama, pee-pee. And I'd say, oh, okay. And we'd run to the bathroom. I'd say, good boy, Shelby, good boy. Well, pretty soon he got to saying, pee-pee, mama, pee-pee. And we'd run. He'd say, good boy, Shelby, good boy, Shelby. I just thought that was so cute.
Now, how old was he when you got him trained?
He was right before 3 years old.
That's really good.
Yeah, he did real good.
Garrett was over three. And I remember saying to Al, now you have got to take him in the bathroom and show him how to do it. Because you've got the right plumbing. I can't do this.
Yeah.
You've got to. And I will, as long as I live, never forget Garrett staring at his dad going like this.
Watching, huh?
He just thought that was the most amazing thing he'd ever seen like that. And Al said I couldn't hardly do anything. It was making me so nervous when he was standing right there.
I'm not laughing. They're too cute.
And then the number two, we had a neighbor said, oh, now here's what you do. Once you get them to do number two in the toilet, leave it there so they can look at it like a prize, you know? Look what I did, and they can show it to everybody. Of course, Garrett always wanted to fish the big ones out because he was really proud of those. Well, anyway, we could go on about the potty training for for days and days, but enough about that. let's give a big hand now to your 1994. Congratulations, by the way. I haven't seen you girls since then. Grammy co-winner. Here she is singing her new hit, Love Didn't Do It, Linda Davis.
You say love felt too high and except for those teardrops in your eyes. You say love's really done you in. Oh, but love didn't do it, she did. You say love's always done you wrong. Turned your heart as cold as stone. It's made you never want to try again. Hope to fly. So you can't blame love for the shape you're in.
Come back. I'm talking with Grammy winners Reba McEntire and Linda Davis today, and congratulations again, girls. And Linda, since you were last here, your career's really taken off, yeah?
It's like a whirlwind. The last 9 months, I can't even start and have enough time to finish all the neat things that's happened to me.
It's probably from all the exposure you got from being on the Vicky show.
Exactly. It reran and everything.
Yeah.
So we got 2 times exposure.
The new album is called?
Shoot for the Moon.
Shoot for the Moon. And you co-wrote one of the songs. Which song did you co-write?
How Can I Make You Love Me.
And you cried while you were writing it?
Yes. Jim Weatherly sat with me and wrote that song, and you've probably heard some of his music in the past. Neither One of Us Wants to Be the First to Say Goodbye.
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite songs in the world. Well, to sit with the man that wrote that was a big treat to start with, but he was always very kind to invite me. We sat and started this song, and I just had to be excused. I had the tears just a streaming. And I know Jim was thinking, well, it's about a sad marriage and a relationship that's going bad. I guess she's experiencing that at home. I guess she's got marital problems. It wasn't that at all. I had to come back in and apologize for taking so long to clean up, but it was just such an emotional song, and it moved me. The melody is so sweet and
it was
sad.
You just probably needed some fem tabs.
I
guess. Who has questions? Where am I going?
With me.
You know, that stuff passes after a few days.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Is there anyone you would like to meet that you haven't met yet?
Oh, me? Idols. Do you have idols you haven't met yet?
You know, the thrill that I got to meet President George Bush and his lovely wife, Barbara, was a thrill of a lifetime. But a person I think I got to work with way early in my career, but I didn't get to meet, is Paul Harvey. I'm a big fan of Paul Harvey.
Paul Harvey, the newscaster?
Yes.
Yeah?
And that's the rest of the story.
Well, I don't know if we are getting the rest of that story.
I'm just a big fan.
Hi, I have a question for Reba. Do you have any plans for any new movies?
Oh, yes, we do. In May, we're going to start a movie for television called Is There Life Out There? And it will be probably out in the fall.
Well, now wait, is Huey Lewis going to be in that?
No, we didn't get Huey. He's busy. But
so you have to recast that part?
Yeah.
So who's your fantasy guy this time?
Ooh.
Have you thought about it?
Oh, sure I have.
Yeah? You want to solicit anybody on the air? Well, I mean, you could solicit.
This girl.
Kevin Costner.
She's going to get me in so much trouble.
Kevin's taken a year off. Maybe he would like to do this.
Maybe I could just, no, really, we already have found somebody.
Oh, yeah.
And we're really looking forward to the movie.
Nobody.
I don't know if he said yes yet, or I could say.
Oh, so you don't want to mention
yeah.
him? Who had a question? Did you have a question? Stand up, huh?
When did you and Linda first meet and decide to record together?
I was pregnant with Shelby in 1989, and they had put me to bed because I was having a lot of complications with Shelby and early contraction, things like that. And I was listening to demo tapes, getting ready for the album after I had Shelby. And Narva would come home from work each day, and he would say, well, did you find any good songs? I said, well, I don't know about if I've heard any good songs, but man, listen, this girl sang. And he said, who is it? I said, I don't know, but she's on a lot of these demo tapes, and I love her singing. And so he found out who it was, and it was Linda. And he found out what she was doing in her career, and we both fell in love with her music and her. And Narva manages her now, and I got to sing a duet with her.
Hi, Reba. I was just wondering if you have any plans to make a record with your sister, Susie.
I would love to do a record with Susie and Paik. Susie's singing strictly gospel now. She has for a while. She's with Integrity Music and doing very, very well. We got to sing the other night on one of the Nashville TNN stations and had a great time with our older sister, Alice. So we had a great time with that.
Yeah. We'll be back. We have to take a break, but we'll be back with more.